Welcome to this hour of blessing on 3ABN Spring Camp Meeting 2011. The pillars of our faith continue here, and I would just like to say that it's a blessing to be here from Camp Meeting. Would you say amen to that?
Amen.
Amen. So those of you that are watching anywhere in the world that are enjoying the programs in your homes or wherever you are, we would like to encourage you to make an effort to be here for camp meeting. There will be a fall camp meeting, and so we would like to encourage you to come and enjoy the blessing here. There's a blessing at home, but there seems to be an atmosphere here, a very spiritual atmosphere, that is a great blessing. Would you say amen if that's true?
Amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord. During this hour, we will have a message from Kevin Hart. He works in the pastoral ministries department at 3ABN. Perhaps if you have called with a Bible question or needed prayer, you may have talked to Kevin Hart. You may have also seen him during the program, Books of the Book, as one of the hosts in the program. So he will be sharing a message entitled Origins. And he has been praying and studying hard and asking for the Holy Spirit to use him, and I'm sure that you will be blessed. We also are going to be blessed in a moment with music, but before that, we'd like to encourage you to join me in prayer for this hour to be a blessing, not only to all of us here, but also to the people joining us by radio, television, and the internet, so they can also be blessed. So would you please stand for a moment so we can pray together? Let us pray. Our loving Heavenly Father, how great Thou art. We see evidence of Your love in our lives and in the lives of others. And we see evidence of Your concern. And Father, we pray that during this hour, You will help us to do our part, to pay attention to the message You have for us through Your servant, Kevin Hart. And we pray, Lord, for everyone here to be blessed. And we pray that the signal will go out strong and reach the hearts and homes of millions around the world. We pray for Your Holy Spirit to vivify the understanding of each individual so that they can understand Your concern for them and Your love for them. And we pray, Lord, that as we look through the Scriptures, we will recognize the voice of God speaking to us. We pray for Your blessing upon the music. We pray for Your blessing upon all this equipment that You have blessed us with. Bless the technical staff. And we pray for Your name to be honored and glorified. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. You may take a seat. I've been very blessed by the music of Reggie and Lady Love Smith. And during this hour, they will be participating. Any second now, they will be walking here next to me. And the message in song that you will hear is entitled Somewhere Between Heaven and Earth. I would like to invite you to listen to these words as you are brought to God's throne of grace through the ministry of Reggie and Lady Love Smith. God bless you. After this, you will hear the voice of Kevin Hart.
Suspended above the world that He made, and below His home in the sky, God in flesh came down to man, and man raised Him up to die. And there on a tree, destiny of every fallen man was held by nails, driven between heaven and earth.
Somewhere between time and space.
And somewhere between judgment and grace.
He became the sin he'd never known.
And as the skies turned black, his father turned his back,
and before that moment he was left alone. He was left alone. Somewhere between heaven and earth stood a symbol of grace, not based on our worth. It was there he endured what we deserve.
For a cross held the hope of the world.
Somewhere between heaven and earth.
Heaven and earth.
Stood a symbol. It was there he endured what we deserve.
For a cross held the hope of the world.
Yes, a cross held the hope of the world. Yes, a cross held the hope of the world.
Suspended above the world that he made, and below his home in the sky.
Welcome to camp meeting. Somewhere between heaven and earth. Boy, those are words to contemplate. It's a privilege to stand here. I'm not even going to try to fill Asherix's shoes. Number one, I don't know what size he is, and number two, they're too fast. So I will do what I can. It was asked of me to speak, and I humbly accepted in terror and in fear. But God has a way of using those who are willing, so I figured if I make myself available, maybe he'll use me. God is good. And before we go any further, I'd like to open up with a word of prayer. Our Father in our heaven, we thank you so much. Our Father which art in heaven, we thank you so much for your love toward us, your unfailing love toward us, a love that nothing can separate, a love that's always initiated, and a love, Lord, that changes us and softens us. I pray today, Lord, that you will use me in some way, that I will be hidden and Christ will be visible, and that your name will be lifted up, and you will receive all the honor and glory today. We pray that hearts might be touched and souls drawn out to thee in love and gratitude is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Memory is an interesting thing. Memory is like a mental file cabinet where we store information from all of life's experiences. It's kind of the cabinet where we hide memories. It's where we store memories. It's where we cherish memories. It's the place where things are forgotten as well. And sometimes the process by which the forgetting happens is an interesting one. Sometimes an external impact to someone's brain can affect the capability of someone to recall certain pieces of information. Sometimes drug use can affect someone's ability to recall certain pieces of information. Old age affects our ability to remember over time. And sometimes a traumatic experience can alter the patterns of the brain where we have trouble accessing certain periods of our life. It's that strange mental file cabinet that we all need. And it's the same mental file cabinet that we all draw from in our decision making. The title of today's message is called Origins. And I know that when you first hear that, most of our minds will go back to the beginning of creation, the creation of our world. But today's message is not about creative origins, it's about redemptive origins. Because I think while both are extremely important, I think our redemptive origins somehow are a little more, have the upper edge. Memory's a beautiful thing. It can bring us back to a time long ago when we were children, and we played out in the yard at our home under the warm sun, under a large, grand blue sky. As the clouds slowly drifted overhead, and as a child, time didn't even really seem to exist until our parents called us back in the house. It's a beautiful thing. Memory can bring us back to a time when we first learned how to drive. Y'all remember that? I'm not that old, but I'm old enough that when I was a child, I was, I think, maybe 11 when my dad started doing this, he would place me on his lap while we were driving in the car. So that kind of dates me a little bit. And we would drive down the road, and his feet would be on the pedals. My feet couldn't reach. And he would do all the pedal working, and I would do the steering. And then maybe a year later, as I learned to shift the gears, he'd let me shift the gears. You do that today, and if we had done that today, I guess my father and I might have ended up in jail. So memory is interesting. And that's a beautiful period of one's life, remembering our first time driving. It could be a high school sweetheart memory could bring us back to. Some of you have married your high school sweetheart, and that is just a precious thing. But memory also can be have its pitfalls. It seemed with Israel, as we look over the history of Israel, it seems as though they had a memory problem. Some sort of spiritual amnesia, put it that way. And as I thought about what to talk about today, my mind was brought back to a passage that I had always felt, that I always gravitated to. Never really figured out how to put it into a sermon, and I pray that I'm able to today. But the Lord put it on my heart again, and it's found in Ezekiel, and I would encourage you to turn there with me. Turn with me to the 16th chapter of Ezekiel. And I will start reading from verse 1 through verse 5. Memory is an interesting thing. The word of the Lord came to Ezekiel. He says, again, the word of the Lord came to me. Son of man, cause Jerusalem to know her abominations. And say, thus says the Lord God to Jerusalem, your birth and your nativity are from the land of Canaan. Your father was an Amorite, and your mother was a Hittite. As for your nativity, on the day you were born, your navel cord was not cut, nor were you washed in water to cleanse you. You were not rubbed with salt, nor wrapped in swaddling clothes, a common practice to the ancient folks. No, I pitied you to do any of these things for you, to have compassion on you. But you were thrown out into the open field when you yourself were loathed on the day you were born. The setting was grim. Babylonian captivity had just begun under the reign of Nebuchadnezzar. The northern kingdom of Israel was destroyed with its 10 tribes over 100 years before at the hand of the Assyrians. And because the southern kingdom of Judah continued in its persistent rebellion, mimicking its northern brothers, so to speak, God had finally allowed them to be overtaken by Babylon. They continued down a path of apostasy until there was nothing more the Lord could do. The Lord had tried everything to call his people back to him, but no response. And so finally, under the reign of Nebuchadnezzar, Ezekiel, along with many, many others, were carried captive to Babylon. And now they sit by the river Chebar, contemplating their circumstances. Strong language here, isn't it? It's almost repulsive. But to the ancient mind, this was common language. And it wouldn't have been as shocking to them when they heard it. But maybe we need to be shocked a little bit today. Amen. It's not the kind of language one would think was needed for a discouraged people. Remember, they're in Babylonian captivity. The complete destruction of the southern kingdom of Judah, what was about to happen within a few short years of this. But Israel as a nation had always called themselves God's chosen people. They prided themselves as the descendants of Abraham. So much so that even before the northern kingdom of Israel was destroyed, while they were setting up the high places of worship after the pattern of heathen nations, polluting the temple of the Lord, setting up idols, bowing down to wood and stone, worshiping carved images, they had, should I say, the nerve to believe that their worship was accepted. As if their lineage sanctified their every act as the descendants of Abraham. And that God would turn a blind eye. And now they sit in Babylonian territory with a similar mindset, and God has to remind them of something. Memory is an interesting thing. You see, when the Lord said to them, your father was an Amorite and your mother was a Hittite, it really was a twofold rebuke. Because they didn't realize that ancestral lineage means nothing if one's actions reflect the ways of the world around them. And so God was putting into perspective that even though they had established the land of Palestine, by example and behavior and attitude, they were really children of the heathen people before them. Father was an Amorite and your mother was a Hittite. It was a rebuke. I mean, we're children of Abraham. How dare you call us children of the heathen? But it was a lesson God wanted them to learn. It was a lesson that God wanted them to learn in times of prosperity. And they failed to learn the lesson. They failed to learn that character, assimilation, is so much more important than ancestral lineage. It was a lesson that they failed to learn over and over and over again. They forgot to remember that origins mean nothing if they're acting like those around them. And they'd also forgotten the nothingness from which God had rescued them. And so contained within this realistic allegory, we find three fundamental questions. Not questions, but it's implied. We're talking about origins. The first question is this. Where were they when the Lord found them? The second question is, what were they doing when the Lord found them? And the third question is, who were they when the Lord found them? These three questions had great significance for the children of Israel, for in their long history, since the deliverance from Egyptian bondage to the very seat they were taking now next in Babylonian captivity, we find them over and over and over and over again forgetting the where, the what, and the who. The where is depicted by this child in misery in the open field. You see, Israel was no great nation. God did not call them because they were great, because they were smart or intelligent. God did not call them because they were strong or wise. God called them out of Egypt. They were slaves. And the circumstances are quite clear when we go back to Exodus chapter 1. And we read verses 8 through 14. It says, now there arose a new king over Egypt who did not know Joseph. We all know the story. And he said to his people, look, the people of Israel, the children of Israel are more and mightier than we. Come, let us deal shrewdly with them, lest they multiply. And it happened in the event of war that they also join our enemies and fight against us, and so go up out of the land. Therefore they set taskmasters over them to afflict them with their burdens. And they built for Pharaoh supply cities, not out of wood and nails. You ever see the rocks that the city of Egypt was built with, those pyramids? I wouldn't want to have to put those things together. So they built for Pharaoh supply cities, Pithom and Ramses. But the more they afflicted them, the more they multiplied and grew, and they were in dread of the children of Israel. So the Egyptians made the children of Israel serve with rigor. And they made their lives bitter with hard bondage, in mortar, in brick, and in all manner of service in the field. All their service in which they made them serve was rigor. Time and time again, they forgot where they were when the Lord found them. This child was thrown out into the open field, and its misery is clear. The navel cord was not cut, something pretty important for independent life. It wasn't washed, it wasn't cleaned, it wasn't pampered with swaddling clothes. No, Israel was in a desperate situation when the Lord found them. They were in need. They're anything but independent. Life was hard and cruel. Life was a series of whips and lashes, a series of directions and kickings and bruises. There was no relief, no light at the end of the tunnel. It was joyless from infancy to adulthood, life in Egypt. And though they were in the midst of the most powerful growing nation on earth, their lives really more reflected the vast arid deserts around them. And it's amazing that they forgot all of that. I wonder, where were we when the Lord found us? It's amazing how we can forget probably the most fundamental question to be answered in our Christian experience. Where were we when the Lord found us? The what is depicted by a child, the child gasping and struggling for air and wrestling in its own blood. The King James says flailing, I believe, wallowing. Israel was well nigh devoid of hope during Egyptian slavery. The promise given to Abraham was all but forgotten except by the Lord. And Israel was gasping for air. They're multiplying in numbers, but their misery was proportionate to their growth because of the decree that Pharaoh had made to administer population control. But Exodus chapter 2, verse 23 says, "Now it happened in the process of time that the king of Egypt died. Then all the children of Israel groaned because of the bondage, and they cried out, and their cry came up to the Lord God because of the bondage." What were they doing? They were groaning. What were you doing when the Lord found you? Did you have it all together? And who were they? The who is indicated in verse 5 of Ezekiel chapter 16. It says, "No, I pitied you to do any of these things for you," this poor baby lying in this field, helpless, "to have compassion on you. But you were thrown out into the open field when you yourself were loathed on the day you were born." Very important to remember who we were before the Lord found us, when the Lord found us. It's hard to imagine that no eye would pity a struggling infant in an open field, exposed to the heat of the sun, wrestling in its own blood. It's hard to imagine that no one would have compassion on a little infant as that. And even today in our modern society, from what I understand, even in the prison systems, one of the things you do not want to end up in prison for is child abuse. Because even the most hardened of criminals, for some reason, that's a sore spot with them. It's hard to imagine that no one would take pity on this child. The Egyptians didn't care about them as long as they met the daily quota of bricklaying. Nobody else cared. Boy, origins are so important, aren't they? And it's when we forget our beginnings that everything else suffers. And it's also interesting to note that when God finally brought them out of Egypt and brought them to Mount Sinai and gave them his law, it's interesting that even the Decalogue itself, that we exalt so high because we recognize that it's a transcript of God's character, that the preamble, the historical prologue, begins with these words, "I am the Lord your God, which brought you out of Egypt, out of the house of bondage." It's so important, Origins, because it sets the stage for everything else that follows. It's the springboard for every action, every word, every look, every choice we make. Where were we when the Lord found us? Who were we? What were we doing? Pretty terrible scene, this scene here. But it was a fitting representation of the history of Israel. But then it shifts from this helpless child to probably the most glorious passage I find in Scripture. I just, something here just really connected with me. Verse 6 says, speaking of the Lord himself, "And when I passed by you, I saw you struggling in your own blood. And I said to you, in your blood, live. Yes, I said to you, in your blood, live." You know, God never gets tired of searching. He's depicted here as a traveler who just so happens to show up at the most critical moment in this infant's life. Isn't that just like our Lord? Amen. You know, he may never be early, but he's definitely never late. Never late. Never stops roaming. Never stops searching for lost and dying souls. Never stops caring for those who are hurting. God is ever on the move, tracking us down. We use the term "when I found the Lord," but really it was when God found us. And some say, well, God always knew where you were. But we never seek after God. That's what the Bible says. There is no one righteous, no, not one. None that seeketh after God. If it hadn't been for the Lord initiating the relationship, we wouldn't even be here. We wouldn't even be having a camp meeting. And that is what Israel failed to remember. Their origins. That God had initiated the relationship. God had been honored the covenant. God was the one who had blessed them with so many things. It was a gift. God was not obligated to do any of these things. He established the covenant with Abraham, but he even initiated that. Men may not notice what you're going through. Women may not notice what you're going through. But God's eye is on the sparrow. He numbers the hairs of our head. He's loved us with an everlasting love. Yes, God cares, even when men and women do not. But the problem is that when we, his people, live out of a disappreciation, an unappreciation for all that he has done for us, the issue is that we misrepresent him. And that really was the issue with Israel, time and time and time again, you know. It did have to do with the fact that they had become like the heathen nations around them so many times, and God had to send judgments and bring them back. And the cycle repeated itself over and over and over again. That was bad in and of itself. But what really made it worse was the fact that they called themselves God's chosen people. And this was no secret title, like the Masons. This was no secret thing. All the surrounding nations knew that they took that name on themselves, God's chosen people, descendants of Abraham. Well, what kind of an example were they giving when they were bowing down to images, throwing their children in the fire, as we find out, that they let themselves be debased to such a level? What do these three questions mean for us today? Why are they so important? Why is it so important to remember origins? Well, it really is everything. You see, because how we view what God has done for us affects every single aspect of our being. It affects everything, including our relationship to one another. In Luke chapter 7, turn there with me if you would. Luke chapter 7, we find Mary Magdalene anointing the feet of Jesus. And after she anoints his feet, Simon the Pharisee mutters under his breath, "The Lord only knew what kind of woman this was." And of course, the Lord heard that. You can whisper, but the Lord still hears. You know, you don't have to say anything and the Lord hears, because he reads our heart. And even if Simon had said nothing, the Lord still would have read what the spoken words of his heart. If he had really knew what kind of woman this was, he would have nothing to do with her. But then Jesus responds to Simon with this parable. It says, Jesus answered and said to him, "Simon, I have something to say to you." "Teacher, say it," Simon replied. "There was a certain creditor who had two debtors. One owed 500 denarii and the other 50. And when they had nothing with which to repay, he freely forgave them both. Tell me, therefore, which of them will love him more?" Simon answered and said, "I suppose the one whom he forgave more." And he said to him, "You have judged rightly." The degree to which we appreciate all that God has done for us is the degree to which we love one another. And that's why God needs to remind us from time to time. The degree to which I appreciate what God has done to me, for me, is the same degree. It's directly proportionate to the level of love that I have for those around me. How lost I comprehend myself to have been before God's intervention in my life determines how I treat those who have not let the Lord intervene in their lives. Perspective is so important. And it's important because it's always about relationship. God is a God of relationships. And that's what frustrated him with Israel so much. We find in Isaiah, "Is this the fast that I have called for? Wasn't it to visit the widow, feed the fatherless, to take them in?" I'm paraphrasing. That's what frustrated him so much, is that his people who were called by his name, who were supposed to represent him in character to the heathen nations around them, were no better. In fact, they were so often worse. That's why it's important, because how we perceive what God has saved us from will completely determine the way that we relate to others and interrelate with others. So when we talk behind each other's back, and we do that sometimes, when we discourage instead of encourage, when we segregate and separate instead of drawing together, we cast a shadow on God's character. And that is why Israel found themselves in captivity. You see, it was always about God's character. God's plan for Israel in the beginning was to make them a thriving nation, an example to all the other nations, a nation that the others would look at and say, "Why are they so blessed? Why are they so blessed? Who is this God that they serve? Why do they call themselves a peculiar people?" That was God's original plan for them. Gratitude. Are you grateful today? What the Lord has done in your life? I believe you are. I know I am. And by the way, I'm preaching to myself because I'm not perfect. I don't stand up here as a perfect person. Well, that's kind of a given, but I'm far from perfect. Put it that way. If we really believe that we've been saved by grace through faith and that not of ourselves, if we really believe that it's a gift of God and cannot be contributed to, then why do we not treat others as if they're deserving of the same gift? I mean, if it's never originated with us, then why would we treat someone else as less than us? It's about attitude and gratitude. There are some husbands who once knew the Lord and for various reasons have drifted, and now they're treating their wives as subservient and inferior, as less than nothing. It's amazing. I get calls like that all the time in pastoral. There's wives who once loved the Lord And for various reasons, they've allowed themselves to drift, and now they don't want anything to do with spiritual things. They don't care about the things of the Lord. There's children that are disrespecting their parents left and right. Children old enough to know what God has done for them. It's a sign of the times, really. And then when we look at society, we just see the results of sin. We see a world out there that could really care less about one another. We hear of these organizations, humanitarian organizations, you know, humanity. On what basis? It's always about what God has done for us. You know, did you know that what gives something its value is the fact that God loves that thing? The object upon what God places his love is what gives it its value. Because without God's love, we have no value, not in and of ourselves. So what is attitude and gratitude? Why are these three fundamental questions so important? Because it should change the way we relate to one another, in the home, in our neighborhoods, on the job, at the bus station, in the marketplace, on Black Friday, when everybody's shoving for the door. The Lord just threw that in my head. I don't know why. But it's relevant because of this. I was in a dark place when the Lord found me. Therefore, when I encounter others who are in a dark place, I remember what the Lord did for me. And I treat them the same. I was a mess when the Lord found me. And therefore, when I see others who are a mess, I don't recoil and turn the other way or walk to the other side of the street. But I have compassion and I have sympathy because I was a mess when the Lord found me. Amen. Origins are so important. Redemptive origins are of utmost importance. I wasn't the brightest bulb when the Lord found me. And I wasn't. I was a high school dropout. I got kicked out of 3 different high schools. And then finally, it was just a mess. So I dropped out of high school. And I was a mess when the Lord found me. I didn't really look like a mess on the outside, but inside I was a mess. And I wasn't the brightest bulb in the tree. But when I encounter others who may not be as eloquent or articulate as myself, I encourage them and point them to Jesus. Because he is the light of the world. I was definitely not the brightest bulb in the tree. And I remember that 1 Corinthians 1:26 through 28, somewhere in there, that God chooses the foolish things of the world to put to shame the things that are mighty. Yes. I remember these things, and that's why I treat people different. Amen. That's why I have compassion. Amen. Not inherent in and of myself. I'm selfish by nature. We all are selfish by nature. And there are hurting people left and right. We rub against them every day. We bump shoulders with them every day. It's about attitude, and it's about gratitude. Yes. And when we forget what God has done for us, whether it be by neglect, by choice, by cherished sin, the relationship with the Lord is not the only thing that's affected, but it's our relationship with one another. So what does your Christianity consist of today? Is a question we need to ask. Veggie patty? Veggie loaf? Vegan? Fried chick? Morning star? Skirts to the ankles? Not a splash of makeup? Humble car? Don't drink? Don't smoke? Meaningless if in attitude and behavior we are a reflection of the world around us. Now all these things are important, they are, but they're meaningless. Descendants of Abraham, what does that mean? We are spiritual Israel, what does that mean? We are the remnant, what does that mean? I don't think any of us have been dancing around a golden calf lately. I don't think any of us have bowed down to wooden images lately or set up idols on a high mountain. Most of us don't swear and we don't drink and we don't cheat. We don't party all night long, but could we in our own way be more trusting of our heritage and church membership than of the Lord who is the head of the church? Because many of us have this subconscious belief that if we show up every Sabbath morning and sit in a pew and hear the sermon and even get moved by the sermon and then stay after for potluck, and fellowship with the saints. All the while we pass by lost and dying souls. What does it mean? What does the remnant mean? The remnant of what? When you go back in Israel's history, the remnant were the few that remained faithful to the Lord. And if we are the remnant church of God, then we should be examples of faithfulness to the Lord. And yes, I have fallen. Yes, I make mistakes. We've all fallen short of the glory of God. But sometimes we need to remember our origins. It's a sad thing when we become comfortable. It's a very sad thing. And that's the danger with time. It's always the danger with time that we forget these things. You know, I was baptized when I was 21 years old. And I don't want to keep talking about myself. It's not because I'm just the best example I can think of. Because I know me. You know, I was baptized when I was 21 years old. And I'm not going to lie, I'm 39 now. So it's almost 20 years ago. 20 years is a long time. Think. A lot of you have a lot more years on me. And I respect that. There's nothing more precious about someone who's advanced in years. I've always loved elderly people because it just seems like they've got the richest stories. You know, a rich heritage of memory. And that's just a precious thing. That's one of our dear church members, Helen, is our babysitter now. And she's, you know, she's advanced in years. And boy, is she a spark. I came home the other day. Our schedules are so crazy. I came home the other day, or rather, I was already home. She takes over babysitting around noon. And the night before, the garbage cans were set out. Not the little ones, you know, these giant things that they give you now. What is it, 80, 100, 150-gallon garbage cans? I don't know. And so she likes to walk. I mean, we always see her walking back and forth in town. Helen, boy, she's a fitting example of health. And I look out the window, and Asher yells at my little boy. He says, "Oh, Helen's here." And so I look out the window, and there she is, pulling in my garbage can. I'm like, precious lady. And that's why we appreciate having our kids around someone who is elderly, because she has a rich experience to draw from. But the danger with time is that we forget these things. We forget where we were when the Lord found us. Continuing in the 16th chapter of Ezekiel. And we won't have time to, this is a big chapter. We won't have time to deal with all of it today. But the Lord continues to speak, saying, "I made you thrive like a plant in the field. And you grew, matured, and became very beautiful. Your breasts were formed, your hair grew, but you were naked and bare. When I passed by you again and looked upon you, indeed your time was the time of love." In the allegory, at this point, Israel had already grown into a nation. And it was their time of love. It was when God really had established them under the Davidic kingdom and the Solomonic kingdom, where God really wanted them to flourish and fit the ideal, everything he wanted to give them, everything that he wanted them to reflect in his own character. "Your time was the time of love. I washed you in water. I thoroughly washed off your blood. And I anointed you with oil. I clothed you in embroidered cloth and gave you sandals of badger skin. I clothed you with fine linen." A lot of this language is confusing for us today, but back in those times, I mean, that was the deal. Badger skin. Badger skins. We don't wear badger skins today, but back then, that might have been like Lord and Taylor. I don't know. "I adorned you with ornaments, put bracelets on your wrists and a chain on your neck, and I put a jewel in your nose, earrings in your ears, and beautiful crown on your head. Thus you were adorned with gold and silver, and your clothing was of fine linen, silk, and embroidered cloth. You ate pastries of fine flour, honey, and oil. You were exceedingly beautiful and succeeded to royalty." And this is the key verse and always the clincher. "Your fame went out among the nations because of your beauty, for it was perfect through my splendor, which I had bestowed on you, says the Lord God." How was Israel's beauty perfect? By his splendor. How are our stains today covered and washed? By his righteousness. And when we start to take the blessings of God and hoard them up for ourselves, if you happen to be so blessed, something usually starts to change. And verse 15 is telltale of that. But you trusted in your own beauty and played the harlot. And it goes on to say how Israel took the blessings of God and started to act as if they were inherently, they possessed them inherently in and of themselves. Origins are so important. Because what they failed to remember was that everything they had during their heyday, during the glorious years, the golden years, they forgot that everything they had was because God had given it to them. And it reminds me of Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse 7. I'll turn there very quickly here. Possessions and blessings. Things that the Lord loves to give us, but things that He will not hesitate to take away from us. If by attitude and ingratitude, we fail to realize the giver of them all. For the Lord God, verse 7, chapter 8 in Deuteronomy, for the Lord God is bringing you into a good land, a land of brooks and water, of fountains and springs that flow out of valleys. This is pre-Palestinian establishment. God wanted to bring them into the promised land, but He gave this to them ahead of time so that they would remember their origins. A land of wheat and of barley, of vines and fig trees, pomegranates, a land of olive oil and honey, a land in which you will eat bread without scarcity, in which you will lack nothing, a land whose stones and iron and out of whose hills you can dig copper. When you have eaten and are full, you shall bless the Lord your God for the good land which He has given you. Beware that you do not forget the Lord your God by not keeping His commandments, His judgments, and His statutes, which I command you today. Lest when you have eaten and are full and have built beautiful houses and dwell in them, and when your herds and your flocks multiply and your silver and your gold are multiplied and all that you have is multiplied, when your heart is lifted up and you forget the Lord your God who brought you out of the land of Egypt, origins, from the house of bondage, origins, who led you through the great and terrible wilderness in which were fiery serpents and scorpions and a thirsty land, where there was no water, who brought water for you out of the flinty rock, who fed you in the wilderness with manna, which your fathers did not know, that He might humble you and that He might test you to do you good in the end. You ever wonder why the Lord tests us sometimes? It's to do us good in the end. We look at Job's experience, and it's certainly nothing any of us would want to go through, but so many of us go through that to a degree on a daily basis, calls all the time, people hurting, going through all kinds of difficult stuff. And I can't say to each one of them why they're going through it. But certainly I think this principle applies every once in a while, that He may do good to you in the end. Amen. And then you say in your heart, my power and the might of my hand have gained me this wealth. And you shall remember the Lord your God, for it is He who gives you power to get wealth, that He may establish His covenant, which He swore to your fathers, as it is to this day. Origins are so important. Everything we have, everything we own, and it may not be much. You know, in some countries it's really nothing at all. But anything we have, anything we're able to accomplish, is simply because God loves us so dearly. Amen. And because of the covenant He made with our forefathers long, 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 long ago. God is faithful. Amen. God is so faithful. God loves us so dearly. He's always the initiator of the relationship. Amen. He's always the one that lifts us up out of the pit, out of the mud, out of the dirt and the filth. He's always the one that cleans us up because we can never clean ourselves. Anytime we start to act like those around us, it's usually a simple reason. It's because memory has been stifled by pride and disobedience. And I think of the words of Ellen White, very short, but it's always resonated with me. She says, we are creatures who are slow to learn and quick to forget. Slow to learn, quick to forget. It seems like God has to bring us sometimes, like Israel of old, 40 years through the wilderness, back and forth, over the same ground, over and over and over again until we finally get it. If I were to look back at my life and be honest with myself, I can see some loops that I've done. You know? But God loves us that much. that he doesn't let us continue down a path where there's a giant pit at the end of it. And so if it means bringing us back and forth over and over again until we learn it, it's always in our best interest. Slow to learn and quick to forget. Israel was quick to forget. We don't want to be like Israel of old, do we? I mean, hasn't God done so much for us? Amen. Hasn't he loved us with an everlasting love? Yes. Haven't there been moments in our life where we can truly see where the Lord just showered us with his love, protected us because of his love, encouraged us because of his love, saved us out of a depressing state because of his love? God is always the one who walks around the field of our life's experience, looking to see who's wallowing in their own mess. And I think he'd have us do the same today. Don't you think? I think God would have us do the same today. Remember, the degree to which we love one another, those outside and those within, is always directly proportionate to the degree that we perceive the mess that God saved us from. Amen. Human history will close with a record of ingratitude. 2 Timothy 2:3 says that. Men will be lovers of themselves and unthankful. But God is faithful. The good work he's begun in us, he's faithful to complete, if we will just simply remember. Sometimes that memory just means simply going back to the foot of the cross. And you know the ground is level at the foot of the cross. There's no place for boasting. It's all the same sea level. Same altitude. And sometimes that's what it takes. We need to go back to the foot of the cross. And it doesn't mean you need to be a drug dealer or a partier or a criminal to appreciate what God has saved us from. Because one look at the cross of Calvary, and it should become painstakingly apparent what our sins cost. Only a God of love would look upon us with pity when no eye pitied us. No eye. Is there anyone here today that has forgotten what the Lord has done for you? I know there may be many out there among our viewing audience. You know, maybe you too have forgotten. And maybe it's time to go to the cross and stay at the foot of the cross until the Lord softens our hearts again and we remember our humble beginnings. The words of probably the most famous hymn go, "Amazing grace, how sweet the sound, that saved a wretch like me, flailing in my own mess. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Why? Because the Lord found me." The Lord found you. He was the one looking. Oh, I was blind, but now I see. Origins are so important. It's so important to remember, as Isaiah says, remember the rock from which you were hewn and the pit from which you were dug. Boy, I pray that we never forget what God has done for us. I pray that we never forget how deep that pit was, how hopeless we were, how powerless we were. And I hope that with every blessing he sends our way, should we be privileged to have those things, whatever it may be in your mind, I pray that we will never see that as something inherently deserving in and of ourselves, but realize that every good and perfect gift comes down from the Father of lights. May the Lord bless all of you as we remember our origins, and may that always affect and change the way we relate to others. Lord bless you today.
Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Kevin Hart from Three Event Pastoral Ministries Department. The Lord has marvelous ways in which He blesses His children. And we are so grateful for what God has done in each of our lives. I know that every one of you is a story that should be told. And I look forward to the moment when we can all sit down in heaven and start hearing the stories of how God worked in each of our lives. And God will draw back the curtain and show us things that He has done for us that we were not aware that He was at work. And we will thrill and rejoice and praise the Lord even more than we know how to praise Him now. And I praise the Lord that we will not be bothered by, oh, I've got to go somewhere. We will have plenty of time to rejoice in the great things that God has done for us.
Thank you.